accounting equation and Excel bill form transactions. In other words, purchases on account, purchases with no cash. Get ready and some coffee because we're going to learn the accounting foundations with the accounting equation in Excel. Here we are in Excel. If you don't have access to this workbook, that's okay because we basically built this from a blank worksheet but started in a prior presentation. So if you want to build this entire worksheet from a blank sheet, you might want to begin back there. Or you could just construct your own worksheet as we go from this point, or possibly just use good old paper and pencil following along as we work through the practice problem. If you do have access to this workbook though, first a word from our sponsor. Yeah, actually, we're sponsoring ourselves on this one because apparently the merchandisers, they don't want to be seen with us. But that's okay, whatever, because our merchandise is better than their stupid stuff anyways. Like our Accounting Rocks product line. If you're not crunching cords using Excel, you're doing it wrong. A must-have product because the fact, as everyone knows, of accounting being one of the highest forms of artistic expression means accountants have a requirement, the obligation, a duty to share the tools necessary to properly channel the creative muse. And the muse, she rarely speaks more clearly than through the beautiful symmetry of spreadsheets. So get the shirt, because the creative muse, she could use a new pair of shoes. If you would like a commercial-free experience, consider subscribing to our website at accountinginstruction.com or accountinginstruction.thinkific.com. Three tabs down below. Example, practice, blank. Example, in essence, the answer key. The practice tab having pre-formatted cells so you can practice the practice problem with less Excel formatting. The blank tab is where we started with a blank worksheet, now basically having our template so that we could do data input into that template, possibly changing the worksheet as needed as we go. Let's go to the example tab to get an idea of what we will be doing. Looking at transactions related to the entering of a bill, remembering that when we think of a bill, there's a couple different ways we can visualize what a bill means. And it's very important for us to see the context of the words that we're going to be using so we can define them and then take action upon those definitions, which is a big problem, I think, in a lot of areas these days. The language is getting kind of confusing, so people don't know what each other are talking about. And that can happen in the accounting world, because whenever we think about a transaction, there are two sides of the transaction. And from a practice standpoint, it's useful sometimes for us to visualize both sides of the transaction. What would the transaction look, in other words, if I was on the other side of the table versus my side of the table? And that gives us a better insight of how the accounting system is working. So when I say bill form here, I'm going to say what might be said in an accounting textbook with text is that we make purchases on account. In other words, we make purchases where we're not paying cash for the purchases. The form related to a cash purchase being a check type of form, the form related to purchases on account being a bill type of form. However, in normal everyday language, you might use a bill if you receive a bill or when you bill the client. When we bill the client, we're saying, hey, we did work or we provided you with goods or services and we're sending you the bill to pay us for the work that we did. So note in that situation, oftentimes accounting software will distinguish by saying, when I send something out, I'm going to call that an invoice. And when I receive something that I need to pay, I'm going to enter a bill. But note that if I receive a bill, it might say invoice on it, because if I'm thinking of myself from the other side of the table, they sent out an invoice, right? They sent out an invoice and I'm seeing it as a bill. So the fact that the thing that I'm paying says invoice on it doesn't mean it's not a bill from the standpoint of us entering it into the system. Because if I was to enter it into the system of like a QuickBooks software, for example, they often use the terminology of bill to be even more stringent than we might use in normal everyday accounting parlance, which is not stringent enough and can lead to confusing. So we're going to say the bill form represents the data input for work that was done for us that we have to basically pay for, that we're not paying cash for. We're making the purchase of goods and services or services on account. So we're going to do our data input over here. This would be like kind of like the general journal, the journal entries that we would put in place if we were thinking about this in terms of debits and credits. But here we're thinking about it in terms of the accounting equation. So if you look at it from a practice problem standpoint, this would be like the data saying, you know, we bought inventory on account. We bought, we paid the utility bill on account, and so on and so forth. And then when we enter that into our system over here, that will be like us entering the bill, which in accounting software might be in the format of a bill form, meaning it'll say bill on the top of it. But from our perspective, it's just a data input form. What we're going to do is enter the actual transaction, not in the form of journal entries, but in terms of the accounting equation to see the actual accounts that are impacted when we enter a bill form. So we'll enter it here and then we'll have to sum it up. Now, this is actually decent practice just for data input and basically using your 10 key. I highly recommend having a keyboard with a 10 key on it, meaning all the numbers like in a calculator format. Otherwise, it's quite painful to be an accountant with a unless you're really good at using the numbers up top. But most of us aren't, because we're used to the 10 key, or at least in my experience. So that's going to be the idea. Now, we have this tab, so it has some pre-formatted cells. So if you just want to do the data input and enter over here, you can. The blank tab is very similar because we already set up our Excel worksheet, but we're going to have a little bit of formatting that we'll do as we go. All right, so the first one, I'm just going to put the date. I'm just going to make up a date here because we're just really focusing in on general forms right now. In the future with this, we're going to do a whole problem so that we can hopefully do like a month or two's worth of data input and see the impact of it. Right now, we just want to drill down on individual forms and look at what they will do from an accounting equation standpoint. So let's first start with we invest cash, because I don't have any money in the system. So I'm going to say that $50,000 is going in the business from the owner just to put some cash on the books. This would be a transaction that usually happens, you know, right off the bat at the beginning, because any new business usually needs some kind of cash to get off the ground, some more than others. If you start a YouTube business or something like that, you want to make money making content or something, usually the cash investment is a lot less. You might need a camera or something, right? You might even do it with your phone or something. So there might not be a big cash investment. If you're going to invest in lawn care or something like landscaping, then you're going to need some equipment. You're going to need a truck. You're going to need tools and whatnot. So there's going to be a larger investment. Where does that money come from? Either the owner takes it out of personal money, puts it into the business, or it comes from a loan that you take out to get the initial investment. All right. So we're going to say it came from the owner. So what happens from the accounting equation standpoint? There's always going to be two sides of the accounting equation. So the accounting equation is assets, liabilities, and equity. So you could think about it in terms of the equation up top possibly, and then get into detail about the actual accounts within the equation. Let's think about it that way. We could say, okay, if this should be invest cash, not cast. Assets are going to go up because cash is going to go up. Now, the way I would think about this is I would systematically think about, is cash affected? In this case, and then if cash is affected, which way is it going? So in this case, cash is affected because the owner is investing cash. So cash is an asset. So, and it's probably the first thing we think of when we think of assets is like cash, right? So cash is going to go up, so assets are going to go up. Now, you might think, well, cash is going down from the owner's account, right? From the owner. That's true, but we're looking at the business side of things. The owner is kind of like the other side of the table because we think of the business as being separate from the owner, at least from the perspective of bookkeeping, even if it's not a separate legal entity. So then the other side is going to be, what is the other side? Is it liability? No, because we don't owe a third party. We do owe somebody, though. We owe the owner equity. So the other side is equity. So the balance sheet's going to be representing its own entity, it's separate from the owner, even though the owner might completely own it because we're talking about a sole proprietorship. The business has $50,000. It must owe that entire $50,000 to someone because the business is not actually sentient. It's not a human being. It's just a holding account. So that asset has to be applied to somebody, either the bank, the third party, but we didn't get a loan. It didn't go to the bank. It's going into equity. It's owed to us, the owner. So now let's do, now let's enter that into our larger equation. So under assets, we have cash, undeposited funds, accounts receivable. We're going to cash. I'm going to say this equals with an equal sign using the left arrows. I'm just going to go over there to the 50,000 instead of typing it in, because this gives me a little bit more tying everything together, right? I can, so because the if I typed it in, I can't do something like this, go into like the formulas tab and like tracing it. So see, I want to be able to trace everything. If something's out of balance, I want to be able to find where it's out of balance. All right. So then the other side is going to go into equity. So equity, then the question is, well, what account in equity should it be? It's not going to be an income statement account because we didn't earn any income. It's got to go directly into an owner account. And if it's a sole proprietorship, we call that owner's equity. If it was a partnership, we'd have to put it into one of the individual partners, whoever invested the cash. And if it was a corporation, then the investment of cash is in the form of the purchase of the issuance of stock, right? Meaning the owner purchases stock from, in essence, the company, which is a little confusing because when we purchase stock normally, we don't purchase it from the company. We purchase it on a stock exchange from other people. But the initial offering is how the money, is how the money gets into the business, the initial investment of the stock issuance. So we're going to say that's going to be 50,000. So notice two sides of the equation went up. So the assets equalize. So if I pull that over here, let's pull that into our accounting equation. So I'm going to do it like this, equals the sum of all of the assets. I'm holding down shift and I'm going to the right. So I'm going, I'm having the sum of all of the assets comes out to 50,000. And then I'll do the same for the liabilities, equals the sum. This is the most used formula, the sum formula, equals the sum of all the liabilities. There's nothing there, but I'm going to use the formula because I want everything to be consistent so that if there was something there, it would pick it up. And so then I'm going to do the same thing for the equity, equals the sum of the equity. And this is going to include the entire income statement. So draws, owner's equity, and the entire income statement, income and expenses, and enter. Boom. Now I'm going to make these white, the text, because that'll stand out better. I didn't do that last time. Home tabs, I'm just going to touch up the worksheet as we go. Font group, and put some, oh, not that. The text only, man. All right, so there we have it. So then what I like to do then is on all other accounts, I'm going to input a zero, which is tedious to do, but I think it's useful to do because it'll allow us to see the differentiation when we go from transaction to transaction. And it also is helpful just for data input. So I'm going to do it like this. I'm going to put a zero tab, zero tab, zero tab, zero tab, zero tab, tab, zero tab, zero tab, zero tab, tab, zero tab, tab, zero 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 tab. Now you could copy and paste it, but I think just tabbing through it is actually fairly easy. And it's actually a good exercise to do because when you do data input in say a database, tabbing through the database is a common way to move through it more quickly. All right, so then let's go to the next one. And let's say that we have on 115. This is going to be the first actual transaction that will be a bill. Let's say we have utility bill. And let's say it was $500. Now, normally, it used to be we would get the bill in the mail. And the bill might say invoice on it. Because when the utility company sent it out, it was an invoice to them. Or it might say bill, we don't, whatever. To us, from a data input standpoint, it's a bill because the bill form means to us that the accounts receivable is going to go up. We haven't yet paid it. Now, if we took that bill and we just paid it, then even though I still see it as a bill that I got from the utility company, even if the form actually says invoice on it, but I don't enter it into the system as a bill. I would enter it into the system from a form standpoint as a check, because I would just pay it with cash. I would just pay it off with a check. So even though it's a bill from a normal accounting, like a normal language standpoint, it's not a data input bill unless I'm entering it into the system because I'm not yet paying it and I want to increase accounts payable. So from a data input perspective only, bill input form means accounts payable is going up. All right, so I'm going to say, so let's go over here and say, okay, accounts payable is going up. So I should make all of these white too. I'm going to select all of these and make them white. So let's go to the accounts payable right here and say that equals, and I'm just going to say the 500. Boom. And by the way, accounts payable is a liability. So if I should go through this part first. So let me go through my routine. Is cash affected if we're going to enter a bill on account? No, it's not affected because it's going to be a bill. Then what are we getting? What are we purchasing? Well, we're purchasing utilities, or we're paying for the utilities that we already consumed. And the utilities, what kind of account is it? Well, it's not an asset because we already consumed it. Therefore, it's going to be an expense in the equity section. So that means that we're going to have the liability is going to go up with accounts payable, and the other side's going to be in equity, which is a expense account. The expense goes up, but the total equity goes down. So let me show you what that looks like. So we got the accounts payable goes up, and it's now we're on the same side of the equal sign. The other side is equity. So if I'm going to remain in balance, if this went up, the equity must go down in order to remain in balance. So this gets a little confusing because we're on the income statement. So remember, if I reported this on the balance sheet, it would simply go into balance sheet equity. But when I break out the income statement, I'm going to keep the equity at its prior point, or investments, and draws or dividends, and its prior point. And then I'm going to record the revenue and expenses in the income statement. Now, when I think about debits and credits, I'm going to say that sales goes up with a credit, and the expenses go up with a debit. In other words, we only think about these accounts really going up, right? Expense accounts go up in the debit direction, and then we take sales minus the expenses. But when we look at it from the standpoint of total equity, expenses are going to decrease total equity, right? Because they're going to decrease net income, which decreases total equity. So I'm going to go over here to utilities. I'm going to put negative of, I'm going to all the way to the left, that 500. So that should put us in balance, because that's going to bring down the total equity. All right. So then if I go back on over here, I'm just going to copy this formula down, copy it down, put my cursor on the fill handle, copy it down, zero cash impact, and then 500 increase to liabilities. That's the accounts payable. Copy this down, a negative 500 to equity. Now, what I'd also like to do is put a little check figure over here to say, how can I check to make sure this thing's in balance? I can see it's in balance, 50,000. These two add up to 50,000. And then this adds up to zero on this side. But I'd like to do a little check figure. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put my cursor on J, and I'm going to add another cell, right click or column, and insert another column. And then I'm going to format that over here to get rid of the formatting. And then I'll make it a little bit larger. And what I'd like to do is a little formula, which is going to be equals the 500 minus, I'm going to put brackets around it, this liabilities plus the 50,000. That should come out to zero if this equation works, because it's the one side minus the other side should come out to zero. I need brackets around it because of order of operations. So 50,000 minus this plus this will be zero. Boom. So then I'd like it to be green. I'm going to do some conditional formatting. I want it to be green if I'm okay. I want it to be red if this is not zero. So let's do a conditional formatting. I'm going to go up to conditional formatting and say I want to say if it is between, let's go between, and I'm going to give it a little bit of clearance because I might remove the decimals. So if I remove the decimals, it might be off by rounding by like a couple dollars. So I'm going to say that's okay. I'm going to say let's go from negative 2 to 2. So if it's in the range, not just of 0, but like negative 2 to 2, I'm going to say that's close enough for our practice problem purposes. And if that happens, I want it to be green. Okay, and then if it goes above that, I want it to turn red. So I'm going to do, or below that. So I'm going to do a conditional formatting. If it goes above, let's say 2, then I want it to turn red. Okay, and then conditional formatting. If it goes below negative 2, then I want it to turn red. Okay, let's test it out. Let's say it's negative 3, turns red. Positive 3, turns red. Cool. So let's go back, undo, undo. So that looks good. Let's copy this down. I'm going to put my cursor on the fill handle. Copy that all the way down, man. So there we have it. So now we've got that check figure. Let's go to the home tab, font group. Let's put some borders around it. Okay, so there we have that. All right, so then we're going to put the balance. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to enter my zeros again. So with this last one, I'm just going to put there was no nothing to cash, tab, 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 zero, tab, zero, tab, zero, tab, 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 zero, tab, zero, tab, tab, zero, 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 tab, and there we have it. Now, the reason that's useful is that I can then select all of these zeros and I'm going to put an underline, home tab, font group, underline. And it wouldn't have anything to underline if there wasn't a zero. So I need the underline, I need the zeros. So I'm going to go here and put an underline, and then I'll go here and put an underline. So notice every transaction is going to be in balance, and then the total should remain in balance. So this is where we were last time with the first transaction, plus what we did this time is going to give us the new balance as of 115, right? So I'm going to do this. I'm going to say equals the sum of these two. So cash is at 50,000. I'm going to copy that, right click, copy. I'm going to paste it, but I can't paste it like just normal because it messes up the formatting. I want to paste it just the formulas so it doesn't turn all the cells green. So just the formulas, and then I can go here and say I'm going to paste just the formulas, and then I'm going to go here and say I want to paste just the formula. Oh no, undo, control Z, paste just the formulas. You know what I was trying to do, Excel. So now we've got 50,000 cash. We've got accounts payable is still at 500. We've got the equity is at 50,000, and we have the 500, which means that total equity is actually our 50,000 minus 500, which is 49,500 down here in the sum area, right? 49,500. Okay, so that makes sense. Now, just remember that on the balance sheet, if I was to make a balance sheet report, it will group all of this together and report 49,500, and then it will have the income statement breaking out the fact that I have a 500, in this case, net loss so far in cash, and then the statement of equity or retained earnings will show the difference, meaning there was our starting point, we entered 50,000 of cash, and then we had net income showing us the difference from one period to the other. Okay, so then let's go back on over and say, all right, let me copy this down. I'll just copy this formula. So there's the 50,000 cash. There's the 500. We're out of balance, but if I copy this down, that should put us back in balance, man. Boom. All right, back in balance. All right, let's do the next one. Let's say that on that was the utility. I should have done investment utility. Let's do 120. Purchase furniture on account. Let's say I'll make this a little bit larger so that'll fit. Purchase furniture on account. And let's say it was $5,000. All right, so what's the impact on our accounting equation? Is cash affected? No, because we purchased it on account. Therefore, instead of the asset going down, the liability is going to go up. So we know that liabilities are going to go up. What about the other side? Wouldn't it be equity again as some kind of expense? That would seem reasonable, but this time we're purchasing a large item of furniture, and therefore we might have to put it on the books as an asset and depreciate it, because from an accrual standpoint, the theory is that we haven't yet consumed it in order to generate revenue. Now you might say, hey, look, I'm on a cash-based system. Note that even if you're on a cash-based system, a lot of times you'll be forced to do an accrual thing sometimes when it is so extreme of a difference in terms of when you consumed something versus when you purchased it, that it doesn't make any sense to stay in a cash system. So in other words, from an extreme example standpoint of this, if you purchased a $100,000 building, even if you paid cash for it, you wouldn't just expense it, right? You'd put it on the books as an asset. Because the idea is, well, that would be ridiculous for me to have a $100,000 expense when the building is going to be used for like 30 years into the future. And therefore, from a matching standpoint, I should be matching up the asset. So the same thing will be true here. Now, you might say, well, the furniture is not that big of a purchase, so it shouldn't be big enough. Well, the other thing is, if you do taxes in the United States, for example, income taxes, the tax code will force you to put it on the books as an asset sometimes, so you can have to follow at least those rules. Now, you still might get a write-off, like a 179 or special depreciation, but it's still going to force you to kind of do that. So from a bookkeeping standpoint, we're going to have to keep that in mind. We're going to have to say, okay, these large purchases, I need to identify them. There shouldn't be as many of them, but I need to locate them and then therefore not put it on the books as an expense, but as an asset. And then we'll have to deal with depreciation, which we'll talk about in the adjusting entry process. So in this, we're going to say, once again, the liabilities are going to go up with the accounts payable. Accounts payable equals the 5,000. And then we're going to say the other side isn't going into equity, but it's going into a furniture and equipment, which is an asset, not a current asset, though. A fixed asset, because it's possibly not going to be consumed within like a year. So I'm going to say this equals then the 5,000. Boom. Let's copy these down. So now the assets have gone up by 5,000. The liabilities are going up by 5,000 and no impact on equity. So also just realize the accounting equation, when I look at it, I could now think about the value of the company by taking the assets minus liabilities would equal the equity, right? So 50,000 minus 500 equals the 49,500, which in theory would be the value of the company if you liquidated it or closed up shop, right? Because you'd have to pay off the liability and then you'd have equity left of 49,500, which hopefully is cash that you could take out of the business. That's why equity is kind of like the book value of the business. All right, so we have the 5,000 here. Let's put in our zeros. I'm just going to say zero tab, zero, 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 zero tab, 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 zero tab, zero tab, 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 zero 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 tab, and zero tab. Let's put our underlines. I'm going to put my underlines here. Home tab, font group, underline, underlines here. Underline, and then underlines here, underline. Okay. Then we're going to say, let's bring down our balance, which is going to be, let's sum this up. So this is where we were on the last balance right here. So now I'm just going to say, this is where I was plus this is going to bring me to my new balance. So I'm going to say this equals the sum, not of the whole thing, but just of the last balance plus the current transaction. Keeps us at 50,000 here. I'm going to copy that, right click or control C, pasting it, not normal, but formulas only. So it doesn't paste the formatting. So we'll paste that, right click, paste formulas, and then paste formulas, just the formulae. All right, and then let's copy it down to double check our accounting equation. Copying this down, so now we're at 55,000 assets, and the liabilities are this plus this, right, 5,500, and the equity has not changed. It's this plus this, still at the 49,500. Book value, therefore, is the 5,500, or 55,000 minus the 5,500, gives me a book value of equity of the company, 49,500. So in theory, if I was to close up the company now, in theory, what would happen? Well, I could sell my fixed assets to get 5,000 in cash, which probably wouldn't be what I actually got for cash, because I wouldn't be able to sell it for the purchase price. But that, in theory, that would be the idea. And then I can pay off the liabilities, which would leave me with cash of the 49,500. That would be the value of the business that I can liquidate, right? That would be the idea. So that's why that kind of makes sense, hopefully. All right. By the way, we could also, you might say this account right here, this liability account, is going to tell us the transactions and when they happened in what's kind of like the general ledger as we enter the data, but it doesn't tell us who we owe the money to. So this liability account, which is an accrual account, it would only be here if we were doing an accrual versus a cash based system, because if we were paying things off by cash as they came due, we wouldn't have to track the accounts payable. If we have to track the accounts payable, we need a subsidiary ledger, which is going to track who we owe the money to so that we know who to pay. And accounting software will usually record this kind of for us at the same time, some accounting software forcing us to be like in balance as we go, but some doesn't force us to be in balance. And this is often where software can get out of whack. People can get messed up. So let me show you, just give you a quick overview of that. Here's our subsidiary ledgers over here. So with this subsidiary ledger, I'm going to put the columns are going to be who we purchased from. So the first utility bill I'm going to say is Edison. Let's say we purchased it from Edison, right? And then I'm going to say this equals, go all the way to the left. I'm going to pick up that $500. So now that went up by 500. I'm going to select this whole thing. Let's select all of this and make the text white again, white text, so it stands out a bit. And then I'm going to add another column for the second purchase. So I'm going to put my cursor on column AL because I want to add a column to the left, right click and insert another column. The next thing we purchased was supplies. And I'm going to say that was from, let's say, furniture, Office Depot, let's say. So that happened on this line, I think. Is this the line? Yeah. So let me get that over here. So now I'm on this column and I'm going to say this equals the 5,000. Okay. And then on the total, I'm going to say the total equals the sum of these two. And then this is going to equal the one above it, the total that we had prior to this transaction, plus the sum of these two. And then it'll close that up. And then I'm going to copy that down to here. So that means that, so notice what's happening. My accounts payable has a total in it of 5,500. That is the same that's in basically our general ledger account or in our liabilities account. And then I've broken out that we owe Edison. I can total up this column, 500. We owe Office Depot 5,000. Okay, that's the idea. So we need that subledger to help to track us. Again, accounting software will often help us to do that kind of automatically, although maintenance is needed to track that. Otherwise, things will get messy. All right, let's go up to the 125. And the other thing we could purchase on account, we purchase inventory on account. So if we purchase inventory, this would only happen if we're in a business that buys inventory and then sells inventory. If you're in a service business, you don't have inventory, right? So what is cash affected? No, cash isn't affected because we're going to purchase it on account. Therefore, the liabilities account, accounts payable, is going to go up. Where does the other side go? Why am I buying inventory? Because I want to sell it to generate income. So you'd think maybe it's an expense of like cost of goods sold, but not yet, because normally we have to put inventory on the books as an asset. Now, remember, there's a bunch of different things you have to consider with inventory in terms of what's your flow assumption, first in, first out, last in, first out, weighted average. Can I be on a cash-based system if I have a really like just-in-time kind of system where I sell the inventory right away or something like that? Because that would be easier. Am I in a manufacturing type of situation where I buy raw materials, have work in process? And so all of those things with inventory, you as a bookkeeper have to think, do I want to take on inventory? If I do, how am I going to approach that? What kind of inventory do I want to take on? And again, target those clients that you have a system set up for, and don't let the clients talk you into taking on tasks that are outside of the system that you're working on, right? You have to balance out your clients to what you've planned to do. So, which is, again, not always easy to do. Dang, clients are always trying to get you to do stuff that you don't, they're like, wait a second, that's not my business model. That's outside my business model. This is work job creep is happening here. Anyway, I'm starting to get a little bit of a flashback, a little bit of post-traumatic stress here. Let it go. It's okay. It's over. All right. I'm back now. Okay. And so now we're going to go accounts payable. And then the other side's going to be in inventory. Inventory is going to be here. And so there we have it. So now let's copy that down. So if I copy that down, inventory has now gone up 1,000, accounts payable 1,000, and then equity. All right. And then let's put our zeros in. Zero tab. Let's put our underlines under this, underline, and then underline, and then underline, and then let's total this thing up just with the last balance plus the current transaction. So it's going to be equals the sum of just the last two, last balance, current transaction. Copy that, right click, copy. Put our cursor on here, right click, paste just the value, just the formulas, pasting just the formulas. All right, and then I'll paste just the formulas. All right, now let's go back on over and let's copy these down. So this will be our balance as of 125. I'll just copy this down. So the 55 plus the 1,000 is 56,000. The 1,000 plus the 5,500 is 6,500. And no impact, this plus this is the 49. So our current value is at 56,000 minus 6,500. Now, one more thing with that inventory, how do we track the inventory? Well, let's just make a little subledger over here. This won't be perfect because, again, it will be dependent upon how you're going to be tracking inventory, remembering that accounting software often has the capacity to track, or many of the QuickBooks Pro or something can track inventory, but you have to determine if the inventory tracking is suited to the needs of the business that you're in. And you might come to the conclusion that you'd rather track the inventory outside of your accounting software system in some cases, or you might think that it's not sufficient in some cases, even though it has accounting software to track. So let's just I'll do this quickly. We're running long on time. Inventory subsidiary ledger. So we're going to make a subsidiary ledger. I'm going to go down here and say this is going to be the amount. Let's going to make it a unit cost. I'm going to say this is going to be the unit change, and this is going to be the total units, and then I'll say this will be the total value in dollars. Now I might need to adjust this as we get into the inventory section of the course more, but this will just give us an idea. Let's make this green. I'm going to go home tab, font group, making this the dark green and white. Let's make this black and white. We'll say this is going to be, let's make it black and white, and let's center it. And then up here, this needs to be, what did I say, 11? Okay, we'll keep it at 11. Everything's at 11. All right. And then down here, let's make this all green, and we'll make it green because it's part of inventory. It's an inventory subledger, bordered green. The text is white. Okay, so then what row was I on? Row 9. I'm going to go out to row 9, and I'm going to say this equals all the way to the left. We'll pick up that 1,000. Now, I'm going to imagine the unit cost is $10. So that means that if I paid $1,000 cash, the unit cost is 1,000 divided by 10, or $100 per unit. And the total units, I'm going to say this is the first purchase we had. So it would be the prior units plus the current units. And the total dollar amount then is going to be the prior total dollar amount. It would just be the total units. It would be equal to the total units times the total cost. So that means that we're just given a subledger telling us the number of units we have. Now, why is this? Remember that if you're actually tracking inventory, the cost of the units might change over time. And if you have similar units, you're going to have to use a cost flow assumption, such as first in, first out, last in, first out, or weighted average, which is going to complicate this a bit. So you have to, you know, keep that in mind. Also, of course, you might have different units of inventory that you're selling. So if you have one static unit of inventory, that's going to be easier than if you have all kinds of different units of inventory that you're going to be tracking. Are you selling stuff online with different products and so on and so forth? So again, there's going to be specialization based on those types of things that you're going to want to dive into more when you get into inventory. I'm just going to try to make this a little thinner and close this out since we're running long. Let's do a spell check on this bad doggy. And we're going to go, okay, ignore that. All right. So I think that's good. So that's the general idea with that one on the bills.